The diagnosis of Asperger's syndrome does not exist anymore according to the DSM-5, the Diagnostics Manual for Mental Disorders. It's been grouped into Autism Spectrum Disorder, or ASD, as it should be. But let's focus on the namesake, Dr. Hans Asperger. Spoiler and content warning, the only Nazi doctor I've ever seen be defended by people who aren't Nazis themselves. Going into this, I honestly thought this one was going to be a very clear-cut case. And while he's definitely not the saint amongst horrible people he's made out to be, it's very intricate. It's quite impressive how well he was able to use the Nazi time to his advantage and yet not obviously incriminate himself, but I'm getting ahead of myself. I'll first be going over his life a bit until I get into the more gruesome parts of this video. The guy was born in Austria in 1906 and died in 1980. Curious little side note, it's said that as a child he was extremely introverted and quote-unquote weird and had trouble finding friends. Symptoms sound familiar? Anyway, he studied medicine at the University of Vienna and started his career as a full-blown doctor under Franz Hamburger, who was, and I quote, a fanatical Nazi. He became assistant doctor at the Department for Curative Education in 1932 and became its head in 1935. The whole reason I'm mentioning this is that his Jewish colleague, Georg Frankl, did not get that position, even though he was 9 years older than Asperger and had been in said department since 1927. Frankl emigrated to the US 2 years later. Asperger's career doubtlessly profited from antisemitism. Asperger had been promoted by the aforementioned Franz Hamburger, the raging Nazi, and promoting Asperger to such an important position after such a short time is certainly suspicious. The two men, even though Asperger never officially joined the Nazi party, had enough ideological overlap for him to blend in with and be favored by Hamburger. Little spoiler alert for later, Asperger was nationalistically as well as German supremacists aligned. In 1943 he submitted his thesis that was published a year later, The Autistic Psychopath During Childhood. Now, it had been assumed that the fact that both Leo Kanner in 1943 and Hans Asperger in 1944 described autism for the first time was a huge coincidence. But Leo Kanner in the US worked together with, drumroll please, Georg Frankl, the Jewish doctor who emigrated after he was denied the position Asperger got, even though Frankl had been more qualified. Kanner got to be known as the first person to describe autism, while Asperger's work ended up being mostly forgotten. That is, until Lorna Wing rediscovered it in the 80s and named part of the spectrum after him. A decision that turned out to be rather unfortunate. Because there's not too much known about Asperger's political opinions until 1938. Well, at least there's no official statement of his. 1938 is important because, in case you didn't know, it was the year that Germany annexed Austria. Even though there's no official statement, there's a list of societies he was a part of. Bund Neuland, Confederation New Territory. A Catholic youth organization which mainly focused on organizing outdoors activities. It was a right-wing German national fringe group of the Austrian political Catholicism and had very clear anti-Semitic tendencies. It published several articles advocating for the persecution of the Jewish population in Nazi Germany at the time. Their club newspaper called the Vienna quote-unquote Jewish Press a corrosive influence on the public life in Austria, attacked Jews as, I quote again, foreign elements in the Catholic German population of Austria, and warned of the supposed dangers of interracial as well as interreligious marriages. No wonder that this society had also been infiltrated by Nazis. In 1938 and 1939, it was suspected that about 20% of the members were illegal Nazis. The Nazi Party had actually been banned in Austria in 1933. Their leader, Anton Böhm, had joined the party in 1933 also, and remained a member even though it was banned. Bund Neuland also was against a parliamentary democracy and advocated for a corporate state instead. The majority of the members were for the German annexation of Austria and felt at best neutral about Nazis. Especially when it came to religion, this group didn't always completely agree with the Nazi party though. They did, however, have significant overlaps. This club didn't have one homogeneous ideology, yet Hans Asperger himself acted as one of the driving scholars and was part of the internal right wing. Bund Neuland, as they were a religious organization, mostly judged the Nazi party on their church politics. St. Lukas Gilde. St. Lukas Guild. So, the doctors in Bund Neuland sent Asperger to join the St. Lukas Guild as some sort of delegate. This group supported the Catholic version of euthanasia. They had the same goals as the Nazis, to quote-unquote upgrade genetics and avoid inherited defects or illnesses. According to Catholicism, neither contraception, sterilization, nor abortion were allowed, so they advocated for voluntary celibacy for carriers of such inherited conditions, as well as eugenics-based choice of partner. Verein Südmark, Club Southmark. They deliberately tried to enhance the German cultural influence in foreign countries via German-speaking minorities. They sympathized with Nazi ideologies and had clear anti-Semitic influences, as well as also advocating for the annexation of Austria. A lot of their members were close to the Austrian Großdeutsche Volkspartei, the Great German Folk Party, which formed a fighting front with the Austrian Nazi Party in 1933. Verein Deutscher Ärzte in Österreich, Society of German Doctors in Austria. Asperger entered this one in 1934. It was clearly anti-Semitic, propagated admission restrictions for Jewish students, and tried to restrict the influence of Jewish students as well as doctors. Vaterländische Front. Fun fact! Motherland translates to fatherland in German. Anyway, it was mandatory for employees of the state to join this one, so I'm mostly including it for the sake of completeness. To be fair, there aren't enough indicators to say that Asperger was a fully dedicated Nazi before 1938. Especially his religious convictions, as well as his humanitarian background, would be in conflict with that. Since the Nazi party had been banned, the movement became only really attractive for the core members. For opportunists, however, which Asperger could clearly be grouped under, the risks far outweighed the benefits. Accepting the benefits that he did manage to get definitely wasn't beneath him, though. He was, at best, complicit at the time. But this is not where it stops. We're only getting started on actual Nazi times now. By the way, a Jewish boy who had been hidden by one of Asperger's colleagues throughout the war wrote a memoir in which he stated that there was an underground anti-Nazi group inside that clinic. Asperger wasn't part of it. One argument that's brought up is that Asperger never actually joined the Nazi party, as I said, which is considered to have been a huge thing, looking at how many of his fellow non-Jewish doctors were members. This didn't mean that he kept his distance from their doings. Asperger did join the Deutsche Arbeitsfront, German Work Front, as well as the Nationalsozialistische Volkswohlfahrt, National Socialist People's Welfare, in April of 1938. But again, fair judgment, if you wanted to go into the medical field where he lived at the time, you couldn't escape from these two Nazi organizations, you had to be a part of them. What you could absolutely escape, however, was the Nationalsozialistischer Deutsche Ärztebund, National Socialist German Medical Association. It was the ideological spearhead amongst doctors. Membership had been limited to Nazi party members, so Asperger was never accepted. He had been listed as an applicant, though. 1938 also marked the year in which he began to sign his papers with the Nazi salute. The exclusion of Jewish doctors, as well as the increased demand for quote-unquote experts to evaluate and sort out, and I quote, unworthy and racially alien children, greatly benefited his career. He became an appraiser at the Vienna Youth Court, as well as that of the National Socialist People's Welfare that I mentioned earlier. On top of that, in 1940, he became a medical specialist for quote-unquote abnormal children at the Vienna Health Department, even though he would later, in 1974, claim to have never reported any children to them. In his line of work, the group he was a part of sorted through the patients of a child psychiatric unit and deemed a total of 35 children to be lost causes. Settlers' causes were entered into the euthanasia program. They were seen as not being able to be educated, so, well, not useful. Not economically useful. Apart from this, he sent at least two children to the Spiegelgrund, a clinic in which the wider public knew that children mysteriously died all the time. The general consensus is that he, a well-educated doctor, not having known about this, is extremely unlikely. Children who were sent there fell under the previously mentioned lost causes category and died at alarming rates. Most of them succumbed to lung infections that were induced manually by injecting the children with high doses of medications. Children as young as 3 or 4 years old died this way. A mother of one of the children he referred to that clinic wrote Asperger a letter that strongly implied that she'd be fine with her disabled daughter dying at the Spiegelgrund. This letter has been listed as one of the more prominent pieces of evidence that parents knew what was likely going to happen. Some parents begged to have their children back, to no avail. Anna Wödel, a nurse at the same clinic as Asperger and the mother of a mentally disabled son, managed to gather enough information to find the head of the T4 program, the euthanasia program. She even met him and begged for her son's life. Sadly, she could not save him. This took place a year before Asperger sent his first patient there. Another horrifying fact is that he victim-blamed victims of childhood sexual assault. Trigger warning for what's ahead. I'll put a timestamp to where you can skip on the screen. He called a 6-year-old girl a whore. His words, not mine. Girls, according to him, provoked being sexually assaulted. He was convinced that some children have a constitutional predisposition, certain character traits that attract things like this to happen. Like shamelessness. Again, I'm quoting. Literal children, according to him, should have been able to reject the abuse. He said that kids who suffered from trauma following the abuse or rape were inherently weak, since healthy personalities should be able to outgrow such violent acts without being damaged. Trigger warning ends here. His stance on forced sterilization can essentially be summed up as, well, being complicit. He said that doctors have to sometimes cut into people's bodies to heal them, and sometimes they have to do the same thing to the body of the people. Eugenics, ladies and gentlemen. Now, autism, the thing that he's known for. It's been assumed that Asperger mainly used high-functioning, another outdated term by the way, individuals for his assessment to protect his patients. If that were true, he wouldn't have emphasized that autism is hereditary. Remember, the Nazis wanted to get rid of hereditary conditions. I literally just mentioned eugenics. His assessments weren't all positive either. He did describe one boy as having more negative effects, yet still having all the traits of autism anyways. He's been doing what we're fighting to this day to undo. Group autistic people into functioning and useless, essentially. He didn't condemn all autistic children, but neither did he protect them all. He picked and chose those he deemed to be useful. After the war, he claimed to have been subject to investigations and even arrested by the Gestapo, the Nazi secret police. There were, however, no Gestapo documents to support his claim, and conveniently, he was the only one to ever claim this happened, as well as the only witness. He also first mentioned this 17 years after the war had ended. Now, you could say that he was just a product of his time, and that's just how things were back then. But why should he be the exception? Why is it obvious for other Nazi doctors' discoveries to not bear their names because of the immense horror they caused, yet is different for Asperger? It was possible to not be complicit at the time, and to actually protect children effectively, like he was said to supposedly have done. Other people from the same time period show that this was indeed a possibility. To this day, his name as a diagnosis is linked to inherent ableism, those originally having been diagnosed with Asperger syndrome being perceived as better or somehow more worthy than those who got the diagnosis of autism. Ironic, isn't it? thank you for listening. Thank you for your time. This has nothing to do with the video, but as I said, I don't want to keep this VTuber situation up forever, and I think I figured out how I'm gonna do that. So if a video is not personal and more, you know, facts related like this one, I'm gonna use my VTuber, and whenever it's more personal or maybe even I go back to some fashion stuff, I'm just gonna film. Okay, yeah. Thank you for your time. It really meant a lot, and you know, you could stay on this channel if you want to. I've been kind of bleeding subscribers since I started doing autism content as well. Yeah, I expected that. But yeah, outros, huh?